Good afternoon and welcome to the session on Ayurveda biology. This session is going to be focused on how modern biology tools can be used for studying AYUSH concepts and interventions. The chairman of this session is Dr. Satyamoorty, who is the director at School of Life Sciences, Manipal University, and head of the Department of Cell and Molecular Biology. He is an expert in the areas of epigenomics and pharmacogenomics, and he has many professional honors and awards to his credit. So I request you, sir, to please come up on this stage. I request Professor Bhushan Patwardhan to please open the session with a few remarks on epistemology-sensitive research.
Good afternoon. After lunch, session is difficult. We are a little delayed, but we guarantee and I have consulted chairman also before giving this guarantee that we'll finish in time. So, and we'll try to also keep some time for questions, you know. So not that we only will talk about, but we'll let's see how it goes. So I have scheduled 20 minutes, of which I'm going to use only 5 minutes and save my time, but keep myself available for questions later. Epistemology sensitive methodology, why it is useful? Important and useful. I think you may have got glimpses from all over. What mistake we have been doing is we were trying to use modern methodology without understanding basic concepts of Ayurveda. And in the process, what happened is, on one way, we reduced Ayurveda to herbal medicine, and not only herbal medicine, but herbal medicine to be tested in a very wrong manner. And on other hand, what we did is completely undermining the basic concepts of Ayurveda based on which they give their therapeutics. So we have two choices actually. You know, one choice is use materials as Ayurveda is telling you. In that case, you lose all the authority to make any modifications in that. You have to follow what Ayurvedic systems are. But you are also allowed to use your own innovation, do modifications and go on the drug discovery route as well as what Dr. Ashok Vaidya calls it, reverse pharmacology model, you know. So you can choose, but you cannot cross and you cannot take advantages of Ayurveda for your own convenience. The message essence is, as science persons, we should not modify Ayurvedic concepts to suit our methodology. We should modify our methodology to suit Ayurveda concept. And we follow this very, very critically in most of our work. And the first lesson I got, importance of epistemological sensitive Ayurvedic methodology, was when I was doing my master's dissertation. And I may have given this example before, but I want to just give you that example which speaks clearly that why epistemological sensitive methods are important. I was working on a plant called Semicarpus anacardium, black nut. In Ayurveda, it is revered, you know, and it is kind of a Ardha Vaidya, they call it as, so much. But at the same time, it is extremely difficult plant to handle. And our job was to look at two things. One is antimicrobial properties, and other is anti-cancer properties. So while looking at antimicrobial properties, came from my own experience. When I was small, you know, when some thorn goes, or some deep wound happens, my grandmother used to put bhallatak, heated bhallatak seed on that. And that used to be the end, you know, no pain, no infection, nothing. So I was curious to know what it is. So I took that as my MSc project and I did antimicrobial studies using Clostridium tetani and Clostridium welsha, which causes gas gangrene. And we showed that at nanogram level, at that time, I'm talking about 1978-79, that time we showed that Bhallataka is specific anaerobic inhibitor. And we should isolate two compounds called bilavanols, which are long chain fatty acids with one side catechol, so very typical molecule, on one side hydrophilic, on the other side hydrophobic, you know, both in one molecule. So we could isolate and we could show structure activity relationship also, that more the unsaturation in double bond or triple bond, then more is the antimicrobial activity. So we showed that. So we were very happy that we are able to show structure activity, we are able to isolate everything. Then the next job was to go for cancer. So we started isolating again. Cancer was simple model at that time, Hafkin, you know. And that model was talking about activity directed fractionation using HPLC. The first HPLC received at Hafkin at that time, HPLC was not there. We isolated everything. We are very happy that we isolated. But when we tested, all the isolated fractions, we reduced activity. We could not isolate any compound which was specific for this anti-cancer activity. Activity was losing somewhere, you know, in between. And we were wondering why that was happening. So this story. Then I talked to Dr. Vaidya Bapu Nanal. And he told me that what you are doing is not Ayurveda. This was in 1981. And he opened my eyes at that time. He said what you are doing is not Ayurveda, because the way in which you are using Bhallatak, not we use that way. Then I asked, how do you use it? He said that there are various ways. But for your experimental design, I would say that you should use it with ghee. That's what he told me. Standardizing ghee was difficult. So I used standardized peanut oil. I asked him, can we do that? He said, not really recommended, but okay, I give you some concession. You can use that. You know. So I used peanut oil. And the moment I used peanut oil, in the group of animals where I was getting 100% mortality between it is saline suspension, not only I got 0% mortality, but I could actually see the rasayan effect. Weight of the animals were growing, luster, hair luster, everything was, I could not believe those results, you know, same material and totally different results. One is toxic, and Hafkin was statutory institute, government of Maharashtra institute, you know. So if our results would have been published that way, Bhallataka would have been banned as a dangerous drug. And same thing happened also with Adatoda Vasaka. Adatoda Vasaka also cold extract, broncho constrictor. When you boil it, bronchodilator, vasicin, vasicinon, wonderful chemistry done by C.K. Atul later, you know. So Ayurveda also, cold extract is given for stopping bleeding, this, that, you know, constricting activity. And when you boil it, it becomes vasoconstrictor. In Bhallataka also same thing. When you give it with some particular vehicle in a particular way, it has different safe promotive effect. Otherwise, if you use with modern blindly done for twin 80 saline suspension, toxic effects. These two things change me completely. And that is the importance of epistemology sensitive method. And you will be able to understand this everything when you work, you know. Please remember that do not vitiate the basic principles of Ayurveda for your convenience, and that is my message in this session. That's it. So before I close, I also wanted to tell you that this story was further confirmed, Bhallataka story was further confirmed by Dr. Ashok Vaidya. He is sitting here. But because I am speaking, I am telling you this story. And many a times we do that. So I take that liberty, Dr. Ashok Bhai. He gave me an example which he saw of parrots. If you see parrots sitting on tree of Bhallatak, you know, when they actually eat Bhallatak fruit, they take scoop and immediately eat it. Why? Because later on we understood that if you keep Bhallatak open, it is susceptible for atmospheric oxidation rapidly. There are double bonds and triple bonds in the side chain. They get epoxidation happens, and then it goes into polymerized resinous form. And therefore, Bhallatak oil is used as one of the best oils for coating phenol bonded, what we call it as phenol bonded, this particle boards, that kind of a solid material you get. Or marking nut, why it is called marking nut? The moment you put Bhallatak oil on cloth, you know, polymer, this happens oxidation, and this epoxide is permanently black, you cannot remove it. So these kinds of learnings which we make from Shastras and nature are very valuable. We should not be pompous to say that we are in science and we have all the authority to test it. You have all the authority to test it, but then you have to treat them as new materials. You cannot treat them or use them as Ayurvedic material. So as long as we are able to make this differentiation, I think science will progress, and that's what the message I wanted to give. Thank you very much. I hope I have saved some time which we can use later for question and answer.
Thank you, sir. The next speaker is Dr. Kalpana Joshi, Professor and Head Department of Biotechnology at Sihagad College of Engineering. She is an expert in biotechnology and molecular biology. One of her major areas is genome variation analysis with special reference to Prakriti concept of Ayurveda. She has received several funding from several national and international agencies. And ma'am will be talking about biology of Ayurveda interventions.
Good afternoon. Just now Dr. Patwardhan talked about epistemology. So with many discussions with Dr. Vaidya and Dr. Patwardhan, I learned some language of Ayurveda when I joined School of Health Sciences. So I was converted to a sort of Ayurveda biologist during my stint at School of Health Sciences, where I learned some basic concepts of Ayurveda, right from Dr. Bhushan Patwardhan about Prakruti and other things, and of course drug development and many more things with him. I'm just initiating this topic on Ayurveda biology. All our collaborators are here who will be talking in details about AYUGenomics or say stem cell project or microbiome and many more things. So I'll be just introducing each topic where I'm participating with them in these research. So after so many years of discussions and brainstormings and self-realization, like I have put up this diagram here. It is mainly for those who are biologists, for their understanding of Ayurveda. So we are always in life sciences, we are doing microbiology, molecular biology. So those sciences, they are, or biological sciences, they are reductionist, where we look at the organs, then we try to find out what is happening to the tissues, what is happening to the cells, then what is happening in DNA, whether it is getting methylated or whether it is inhibited by miRNAs, or are there any receptors or are there any inhibitors which are inhibiting certain processes. So we are in a way reductionist, although we call it as life sciences. And in the contrary, when we look at Ayurveda, we always call it as holistic science. So how it is holistic, or it is also called a science of life. See, first is life sciences and Ayurveda is science of life. So what I understood was, like, Ayurveda talks about macrocosm and microcosm. They talk about panchamahabhautik theory of Prakruti, or say developing rasas and gunas in plants through panchamahabhuta. So Ayurveda, as our understanding grows, we know it is an holistic science in the contrary to the life science. Our first experience, like my first experience about Ayurveda formulations and making formulations based on Ayurveda knowledge and using them the modern way in proper rheumatology clinic in collaboration with Dr. Chopra. So there were three basic diseases, diabetes, hepatoprotection, and arthritis. They were being tackled with Ayurvedic formulation. So this was my first experience working in a project related to Ayurveda. And this project of about 3 years has really given me very broad view, or it has opened my eyes, and I got to know several things about Ayurveda or how you can use it for better health. With this project, like, we were always into discussing how Prakruti affects treatment. We could visibly see that unless you determine Prakruti, it is very difficult to prescribe some Ayurvedic medicine. That was the time when I had been to USA and back with some knowledge about pharmacogenomics. Or you could say that was the new term that was just developing in modern science. And when we were discussing about Prakruti, like, it's it was a striking realization that Prakruti has some similarities with pharmacogenomics. Or you can prescribe the drugs to avoid adverse events because of the Prakruti. So that was, I felt like beginning some work on AYUGenomics with Dr. Patwardhan, or developing ideas how to test whether Prakruti has genetic basis using some genetic tools. So it was during Nimitli, like several discussions with Ayurveda experts and of course scientists like Dr. Satyamoorty, it developed our horizons and we put up some work on HLA typing and Ayurveda prakrutis. So we analyze HLA types in different prakrutis and published our first paper in international journal JACM. So with this proposal, like we were talking about prakruti genomics and approaching various funding agencies to give us some grant to start this work, because our work was in very small n is very important. It was very small number, n 76. So we wanted to broaden this research and actually get into the real results of this particular connotation. So this was the time when Professor Valiathan, he took initiative, like he mentored us in developing some of the projects under the banner of Science Initiative in Ayurveda. Under Science Initiative in Ayurveda, several meetings with big scientists or molecular biologists, genomic scientists from CCMB, IIC. So we took part in those meetings and brainstorming, and whole concept of prakruti genomics or dosha prakruti and its connotation with genomics was developed. Dr. Satyamoorty is here, so we tried to look at prakruti and its correlation with genetics in form of whole genome SNPs, then gene expression analysis and epigenetics with Dr. Satyamoorty's help. So various projects were developed under the theme of Ayurveda biology. So we had our collaboration in area of genome variation analysis and gene expression profiling of human dosha prakruti. So we were going to confirm our findings, which were done on very small number of subjects with different prakrutis. There were several projects on rasayana, using amalaki rasayana or rasayanas in model like drosophila. Maybe you heard yesterday some story. So drosophila, I think for the first time was used here in Ayurveda, using proving some concept of Ayurveda. Then immunology, where they studied panchakarma and its effect on immunity. So many projects were developed under ASIA. And then later on it was called as Ayurveda biology. So I will not go into details of this work since Dr. Satyamoorty will be presenting this work, but we had a lot of good time discussing with and actually doing work with CCMB, IIC and Manipal, and there were several good outcomes out of this project, and one of them is genome-wide analysis correlates Ayurveda prakruti, where we showed some remarkable genes correlating with different prakrutis. Then, of course, DNA methylation we studied, and we showed that kapha prakruti is connoted with some of the genes in obesity. So this work kept on continuing at a very big level, and we came out with several papers and publications in this area. It also brought up some interest in Cambridge and other countries, and we had some collaborations and had some work done on chemogenomic approaches to find out what is mode of action of Ayurveda drugs and many more things. So that was very wonderful learning. That period was something where I learned a lot of things from Ayurveda experts as well as from our collaborators. Later on, when we worked on Prakruti and actually showed that there are a lot of many other groups also were working, Mithali's group. So we showed that some of the genes are very tightly correlated with Prakruti. But what next? How do we use those information for the treatment or actual therapy of Ayurveda therapy to the patients? So based on the discussions, it was decided that we take up some project in asthma, where we would show proper Ayurvedic treatment is given to the patients, and then what happens to their epigenetics, if there are any changes in their cytokines and so on. So that was the time when I came across this excellent paper in NEJ. What this paper said was that in 200 years, asthma as a disease not much changed. There is lot of progress on diagnosis, there is lot of progress on biology and genetics of asthma, But medicines did not change much. They were all symptomatic medicines, which were of course histamine release inhibitors, or they were bronchodilators. There was nothing which could actually tackle or reduce IgE level, which was responsible for allergic asthma. So is there anything which would actually remove the root cause of asthma, or environment and physiological interactions? So there was nothing related to it. Now there are certain monoclonal antibodies developed as a treatment for reducing IgE. So that was the time we consolidated our project on asthma. So this asthma, our hypothesis was giving whole genome Ayurveda therapy, which was actually removing vitiated doshas. Then there was some drugs, and then there was some diet and rasayanas. It might be effective through epigenetic modulations, because like as we all say, ki person's genetic doesn't change. So any treatment, it would not change the DNA sequence in you. Then what would it change? How would it ameliorate the disease, or how would it reduce the asthma? So we thought that it could be because of the modifications in terms of DNA methylations or epigenetics. So that's how we decided to look at epigenetics in asthma when whole system treatments were given. So in this, like the whole approach, like those who are familiar with Ayurveda, they know that the treatment is almost personalized in Ayurveda. So if asthma is kaphaja asthma, there is different regimen. If asthma is vataja asthma, there is different regimen. So how to use these different, if patient comes with kaphaja asthma, he would be getting some treatment. If he is vataja asthma, he would be getting some treatment. Then how do we manage our clinical trial? You all know that there are consort guidelines, and we have to follow certain rules for registering our clinical trial and treatment. So what here, what we did was we kept black box approach, which was almost personalized approach, where one particular type of asthma would get certain kind of treatment and another kind would get a certain kind of treatment. So we meticulously followed diagnosis of asthma as per Ayurveda. It was called as tamakashwasa. So tamakashwasa patients were identified, and they were also diagnosed with other methods which are in modern medicine as per the ICD-9 classification. So both patients were classified as bronchial asthma or say tamakashwasa based on both systems of diagnosis. And then we had an SOP which was decided, of course, with consultation of many Ayurveda experts, and we consolidated a particular SOP for treatment of kaphaja asthma and for treatment of vataja asthma. This project was in collaboration with Tirak Ayurveda. Tanuja Nesri was our collaborator, and Dr. Satyamoorty was our collaborator for epigenetic analysis. Then what we did was, you all are aware, like the treatment regime was giving improving digestion, pachan, snehan, svedan, snehapan, emesis or vaman, virechan, shaman and rasayana. So this treatment continued for almost 24 weeks, but we had very good compliance. Hardly any one or two patients left the trial. Otherwise, most of the patients, they were very nicely cooperated. They cooperated with us in the trial. And then there were two kinds of treatment regimes for kaphaja and vataja. So coming to the results, like results were so surprising. Of course, I would say it didn't surprise me because of my previous experience. But our modern medicine doctors like Dr. Salvi, he was definitely surprised to see the results. And if you see, the cytokine bioplexing was done, and Th2, Th1, the desired cytokines which were needed to be suppressed, they all were suppressed. The cytokines, pro-inflammatory cytokines, they were suppressed. They were almost equal to the normal people. Immunosuppressive cytokine like IL-10 was better after the treatment, almost better than the controls also. And to our surprise, the biggest thing was the IgE level. IgE or allergenic antibody is the key molecule in developing allergic asthma. And IgE we found was almost reduced to 50%, very significantly, with significance 0.03. was reduced almost by 50%. Now we had some hypothesis set for why IgE would reduce. So that was the time initially when this trial was initiated. There were some stalwarts in Ayurveda who were involved with us, and they said asthma is disease of stomach. Do you all, is it that any biologist would believe that asthma is disease of stomach? I was about to laugh, but since they were very senior people, I didn't laugh at that moment, because we all know asthma is disease of lungs. But then this has proved that asthma is disease of stomach, because IgE levels were down. So then we prepared a model where we showed that how cytokine IL-2 is involved in it, which of course gets secreted from Peyer's patches, is now primary lymphoid organ. So there may be something happening in our primary lymphoid organ modulating the cytokines. So this is how, like, this work is published in journals. After this, like, we saw the treatment with rasayana continued for 6 months, and then patients were non-asthmatic almost for a year. After our trial was completed, we followed the patient and we found that there was no exacerbations or there were no attack precipitation almost for a year. So that was because of the magic of rasayana. So rasayanas are something which are bringing out the changes or modulations in our body. So we thought, how are they acting? How the cells producing IgE were again gone back to producing IgG? Is there something at the stem cell level? So this is how, like, we started discussing on stem cells and using rasayana for stem cells. And with Dr. Bhonde sir, we had a paper or thought leadership article on Ayurveda for translational stem cell research. So this brought us in developing a proposal where we decided to have human mesenchymal stem cells and study effect of rasayanas on them. So we all know that Ayurveda has rasayana therapy, and there are different general rasayana, like yesterday we heard Vidania, Asparagus, Shatavari, and Tinospora, and then there are various classes of rasayana like Rudya rasayana, Medya rasayana. So we decided if these rasayanas are making any changes or changing, differentiating stem cells into Rudya or say cardiac muscles, or whether they are differentiating into neurons or say bones. So we looked at that, and then the results are really amazing, because we found that some rasayanas, they actually differentiated human mesenchymal cells, stem cells, into, this is Van Kossa staining, and they differentiated into osteogenesis, or they differentiated into osteogenesis. Same thing happened with adipogenesis. So like Ayurveda talks about rasa, rakta, mausa, asthi, majja, and shukra. So this is their hierarchy, like how each dhatu is nourished and how one dhatu promotes other dhatu. So if adipose or medya dhatu, if it grows big, then naturally asthi is affected. And like there are so many modern science papers which show that obesity gives rise to bone loss or osteoporosis, and also then it affects the reproductive system. So we were amazed to see that some of the rasayana, they had potential where they did not differentiate stem cell, or they stopped differentiation of stem cells to adipocytes. So this may be improving further the bones or the majja or say shukra. So this is our publication just 2 years back, like herbal preconditioning induces proliferation and delays senescence. So many other, like there are so many ideas or fundamental principles in Ayurveda which we need to explore, like rasa, virya, vipaka, dhatu. Ghee is something which Ayurveda experts keep on telling us to eat 5 spoons a day and so on. And on the other side, we are told, no, Kalpana, you are so fat, stop eating ghee. So what is there in this ghee? So we studied ghee and found that there are a lot of polyunsaturated fatty acids and many more good fats which are good for protecting your cardiac health. So such some initiatives are taken, but still there is lot more to do. We had some paper on traditional phytochemistry identifying drug bite test. So deals with rasa, because rasa of any drug is very important. Based on rasa, we are able, whether it is madhura, tikta, we are able to identify what could be its activity and where it would work in prakrutis. Similarly, like we studied topically massaged oil in neonates, whether it has got any advantages, and we did find. So a lot of concepts are there. So we need to actually develop some experimental approach to explore these concepts, and it could happen only through discussions between Ayurveda experts and lab people like us. So I think my gurus are here. Professor Valiathan, he always supported me, Dr. Patwardhan, Dr. Ashok Vaidya, Dr. Darshan Shankar, I think he was here, but he's not in this audience. But they are the ones who always encouraged me, supported my ideas, and always guided me throughout all my research. And of course, the funding agencies. Thank you so much.
So the next speaker is Dr. Ramesh Bhonde, Director, D.Y. Patil University. He is an expert in stem cells, regenerative biology, and tissue banking and engineering. And he is going to speak on Ayurveda and regenerative medicine.
Okay, thank you so much. I am really happy to be here because the NCCS is actually from where I retired earlier and then joined Madhya Pradesh University at the regenerative medicine. And now I am at the D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth. So the whole concept of Ayurveda, whether we have to test it on the modern platform, then it came to our mind that stem cells would be a very good platform because they proliferate, they differentiate, and there is a need to enhance their proliferation for the therapeutic purposes. At the same time, one can also think of Ayurvedic rasayanas or the Ayurvedic medicine, herbal medicine, where it is proven that they can give rise to cartilage or they can give rise to bone differentiation. So we thought, why not use stem cells, human stem cell, as a platform to give evidence-based science to the Ayurveda. Ayurveda is an ancient science. It is known people are getting cured, their disease being controlled. But the mechanistic view, whether it will be possible to use the stem cell as a model to test the potential of Ayurvedic rasayanas. So luckily, we were getting the funding from the Scientific Engineering Board, SERB, DBT, and we got, with the help of Dr. Kalpana Joshi and me, we collaborated. We got good funding for that, and now also we will be collaborating on other project with D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth and Sinhagad College. So the whole idea is, I will just talk about what the stem cells are, because this audience may not be aware of, or if they are aware, they can brush up their knowledge. So the stem cells are the cells, I mean, there are several definitions. People told it as elixir of life, promise of immortality, and so on. But the point is, the stem cells are the cells which have not forgotten their mitosis. That means they are in a constantly mitotic division. We all know that the stem cells are present in the human bone marrow. So human bone marrow stem cells, they give rise to the entire blood, the hematopoietic stem cells, as we call them. And the second, which are the supporting stromal cells, which are called the mesenchymal stem cell. And these mesenchymal stem cells are important because they are stromal cells. They proliferate, they differentiate. So they show all the stem cell properties, but at the same time, they are not immunogenic. And therefore, it is possible to have allogenic stem cell transplantation using mesenchymal stem cells, which don't express HLA antigen, neither they stimulate co-stimulatory molecules. And another thing is, actually, there is a hierarchy of stem cells that you starts from totipotency, the zygote. After the end of fertilization, what we get is a real totipotent cell which can give rise to the entire animal. But as the division processes, the cleavage takes place, the potency goes on limiting, and then the totipotent becomes pluripotent, multipotent, bipotent, unipotent. So that is what is shown. And another thing is the classical thing about the stem cell, that when a stem cell divides, it divides into one stem cell and one committed cell, something like a semi-conservative mechanism of DNA replication, so that the stem cell pool remains more or less constant, although there is a depletion with aging and so on. But the question is, this property of stem cell division, as what is called as asymmetric division, is extremely important, which is not there in the somatic cell. So the stem cells differ from the somatic cells in that they, because the somatic cells, they are arrested in G1 or they are, will not replicate, but the stem cells have replicative ability. At the same time, they have the potential for differentiation. So that makes stem cell a unique cell. And now we also know that there are stem cell pockets in the bone marrow, in the skin, in the gonads. But now almost stem cells are present in most of the adult organs. And this is just to show the cartoon, what do I mean by differentiation? That the same stem cell raw material, you can have different bakery products, you can have RBCs, WBCs and so on. So the sources of stem cells, now here we are not working on embryonic stem cells or fetal stem cell, but we have specifically chosen adult stem cells, which would have less ethical issues. And that too from the biological west. So we are using umbilical cord, placenta, amnion, or the adipose tissue, which is derived from the liposuction and so on. So these will be the sources, and these are the beautiful sources, so we can have trash to treasure concept, wherein, because it's a really a biological waste, so in, we can isolate the stem cells from that, and it's possible to use these stem cells as a platform. And because the human brand is extremely important, because what is true in mice may not be true in man. And the same thing is here, that since you have the human cells to handle, the effects or the results can be extrapolated to the further the human case. So here we have amnion, menstrual, so many things are there. We also shown that there are stem cells in breast milk. So actually, these are all the sources, and the surprising thing is the adipose tissue, which is always a neglected one, has the maximum stem cells. And you will be surprised to know, so it is better to have little fat than no fat at all, because it can be used for autologous stem cell transplantation. And there are clinical trials happening in Baroda and Ahmedabad using autologous stem cells from the patients themselves into the knee joint for osteoarthritis repair, and the results are really fantastic. They do get the regeneration of the cartilage, and the patient feels, first thing is, there is no pain in the knee. So I have been contacting those persons because I was a part of that clinical trials, as well as in the stemputics we have done some clinical trials with bone marrow stem cells, and I was also part of stemputics. So the question here is that stem cell can be used as a drug itself, and it can also be used as a platform for drug screening, making it an amphibious, like amphibians. So the advantages, as I was mentioning, that there is no risk of rejection, because the question is, they are not identified as a foreign, and therefore they are not rejected, and that makes them a suitable candidate even for therapeutic purposes. Then no risk of teratoma formation, which is there in the embryonic stem cell. The embryonic stem cells are so plastic and elastic that you cannot regulate or control their differentiation, and they can play havoc. So the ICMR and DBT guidelines, it is a permissible result, but with some restrictions. You have to use it for research purposes, not certainly for therapeutic. But some of the cells have been now by ICMR, especially bone marrow stem cells, they are permitting clinical trials, adipose tissue stem cells clinical trial, even umbilical cord stem cells have been used for the diabetes and so on. Then they are multipotent, precise identification, so many advantages are there, efficient, large scale expansion. Now when we are as in stemputics, we have shown that a seed of 6 million cells, if you use, you can expand them into almost 350 million cells in a span of 3 weeks. And all this is a level of expansion. We can use growth factors. We used to use beta FGF. But now the question is, can we expand these cells by using Ayurvedic rasayanas? Ayurveda is known for such kind of proliferative activity, anti-senescence activity, because stem cells are normal. They do show senescence. So whether it is possible to use rasayanas for their anti-senescence activity. So that was another aim that we were having. So the background here, we all know Ayurveda, ancient science and so on. I will not go into that. Now, Dr. Kalpana Joshi has taken some of the slides since we were collaborating. So I will skip that so that I can complete. So the question is, we were interested, there are three things that one can look for the stem cells when you use as a platform, whether a particular rasayana has a proliferative activity. Secondly, whether it can differentiate into lineage-specific differentiation, cartilage, bone, or adipose tissue, or whether it is because I have shown that some of the rasayanas can be used to convert these stem cells into islets of Langerhans. So diabetes being my first choice of interest, so I was always interested whether stem cells can be converted into insulin producing islets of Langerhans, and yes, it is possible to use certain rasayanas, and of course the cocktail of growth factors which we have already developed, and we have published those results. And secondly, whether they can also have some anti-senescence activity, because Ayurveda is known for the, especially for the aged people, to have graceful living, how one can use rasayanas. So that was another one. And of course, this is the list which we wanted to show. So we have first shown with Tinospora, then Vitaria and Amalki. All these rasayanas were in our mind, but then DBT asked us to focus only on two rasayanas, so we did that. I will skip that. So this also was published. Then the one which we have done, that is Dhanvantari Kashayam, is another medicine which is prescribed for anti-aging kind of thing, which I was in School of Regenerative Medicine, Bangalore. So we tested this compound with another collaborator, Sudha Warrior, and we have shown that this has delays the senescence. The question is, delay of senescence is extremely important, and you can count the senescent cells by particular staining, and then it is possible. So you can have that when we treated the stem cells with the Dhanvantari Kashayam, you can show that their Ki-67 is a proliferative marker, then the P21 is decreased, and you can show that blue cells are the senescent cells untreated, and here the senescent cells are almost nil, or maybe one or two. So that shows that it can delay, and this will be published in Cell Proliferation. Then what we did for this project, that we took the help of these ICMR guidelines approval for handling the umbilical cord derived mesenchymal stem cell. They are called as UCMSC or Wharton jelly derived mesenchymal. So we can cut it. As I told you, again, it's a less ethical issues. We used to get the samples from the Manipal Hospital, and we used to make them into small pieces, and then ultimately, using a particular methodology protocol, we were used to get such kind of cells having a fibroblast-like morphology, cells tapering at both the ends and very nice to look at, and they proliferate very nicely. So once you get the cells, primary culture, you can expand them and they can go up to 10 to 20 passages, and later on they will wither out because they are normal cells. And we are not handling the transformed cells or the cancer cell lines. And since these are normal cells, that is the beauty, that we can test these compounds when they are in their normal finite lifespan. And then we characterize, because it's a ritual, we have to show that what we have isolated are the stem cells and nothing but stem cells. So we have to show that they are positive for certain CD markers and negative for certain CD markers. So they are positive for CD73, CD90, CD105, negative for CD34, 45 hematopoietic markers, and they should be able to differentiate at least into three lineages, the adipogenic, chondrogenic and the osteogenic. So we confined that these are bona fide, and then we tested some of these compounds, and we can show that really they have the proliferative activity, especially the treatment of Tinospora cordifolia and Vidania. So two compounds and in very low concentrations. And another thing is, at the same time, we can prove that these are not toxic to the cells. So simultaneously, you can assess the toxicity, the viability and the proliferative activity of the compounds. And that is the beauty of stem cells. Similarly, we have shown that there is a DNA replication by bromoxyuridine. I will not bog down much with the data. Then cell cycle analysis also we have done, and we have shown that how they are proliferative. And here again in this we have shown that they have anti-senescence activity, or this senescence can be delayed, or the treated cells with these compounds do not show much senescence. Because even with bone marrow stem cells, we have shown when I was in stemputics that they do show senescence after certain passages. So one has to use for the therapeutic purpose the stem cells in the early passage, even before two or three passages before they go senescence, because they can perform the best when they are in their phase of growth phase. Because once they are under senescence, naturally they will not be able to perform their paracrine secretions of the cytokine release factors and so on. Then this already you have seen osteogenesis. Okay, then also this you know. So finally, what we show that there are, the stem cell is a very good platform for screening Ayurvedic rasayanas to test their potential of proliferation, differentiation, senescence, and so on. And this was supported by DSTCRB in collaboration with, of course. Now, what I want to show that in the D.Y. Patil Vidyapeeth, in the dental college, we have established a GMP grade, that is good manufacturing practice stem cell laboratory, which will be approved soon by the FDA, and we can grow the cells from any tissue, and especially we are connected to the hospital since this facility was made in dental college. We are starting with dental pulse stem cells from wisdom tooth as well as from the shed, that is the milk teeth. And recently we also got grant from, that is big grant, BIG, Biotechnology Initiative grant, to make the bioartificial gingiva using gingival stem cell. So this will have a translational application and we can go for clinical trials because we have the GMP facility. And another thing is, this facility is available for all to work and we can get your things done, of course, on the payment basis, but under the GMP conditions, and it should be possible. So this is what we grant. Thank you.
Thank you very much. To finish a little bit ahead of time, we may have time for a couple of questions, if you may have.
In Ayurveda, there is obviously naming of stem cells. It says in Ayurveda that the seventh of the Saptadhatus, Shukra, is present throughout the body. Now, generally, Shukra is translated as reproductive tissue and often limited to the regenerative procreative tissue. I personally believe that Shukra includes stem cells.
I didn't get you.
I personally believe that the Saptadhatu Shukra actually refers to stem cells. Could you comment on that?
Yeah. Because they show some properties of stem cells. As I told you, they are centrally different from embryonic stem cells, which can literally differentiate to any type of lineage. For example, embryonic stem cells have been shown to give rise to germ cells as well. But these are adult stem cells which have little limited capacity to differentiate.
Dr. Bhonde,
yeah.
Congratulations for this marathon journey that you have had in stem cell research. And we thank you on behalf of all the people who believed ancient insight and modern discovery to join us. But what I have is some fundamental questions. When a stem cell divides into a progenitor cell and a daughter cell, there's a distribution of mitochondria also.
Right.
Now, we sometimes forget that there are old mitochondria, there are young mitochondria also. So how does segregation occur of old and young mitochondria? Because primarily, the metabolic machinery and as the work horses of the cell, mitochondria are very important.
Right. So here I say basically these are adult stem cells. So these are not embryonic. So here also it may not necessarily every time we'll have asymmetric division. But that aspect we'll have to consider. Because we at only cellular level, we want to see the effect, whether it is said proliferative, differentiative or anti-senescence. But we will look into that also.
I request Dr. Satyamoorty to please felicitate Dr. Bhonde. So the next speaker is Dr. Yogesh Shouche. He is the Principal Investigator, National Center for Microbial Resource at National Center for Cell Sciences. He has a research experience of 28 years in the field of microbial ecology and molecular taxonomy. And sir, his group, along with experts and physicians from Ayurveda, have initiated a study to explore underlying biological mechanisms of basti through microbiome perspective. So sir is going to speak about it today.
Thank you very much for the organizers to give me this opportunity, especially Girish, who made this request. And I am going to make this opportunity to make one point at the beginning. Since many stalwarts in Ayurveda biology research are present here, I am going to speak on microbiome and Ayurveda concepts, because I have been asked to speak on that, and today microbiome is a buzzword everywhere, so probably people want to hear about microbiome and Ayurvedic concepts. However, there is a very important aspect of microbiological research in Ayurveda which we had done almost a decade ago, and I personally feel it was a very interesting study. We had taken up one Ayurvedic preparation, Kutucharishta. We had followed its fermentation for the entire period using proper standard protocol in Ayurveda. We had studied how different microbial successions occur, and with the help of a chemist, we had studied how different chemical compounds are synthesized at different stage and the final composition. We had gone further and isolated which are the bacteria that are present in the final stages of the fermentation. Interestingly, we had found probiotic lactobacilli. Those lactobacilli, we had done some cell culture studies, and we had found to have capability to be having probiotic activity, and not only that, they were also capable of inhibiting the adherence of pathogenic bacteria to intestinal gut cells. So I thought this was a very, very interesting study, but unfortunately that line was never taken up. But I do strongly feel even today that such studies must be done on all those Ayurvedic preparations that are made by several days of fermentation, microbiological aspects, role of different bacteria during the different stages of fermentation. This is something which needs to be studied. And with that, I'll now come back to my main topic, human microbiome and how it is correlated with Ayurveda. So I'm going to talk about going to give you three different examples. But before that, a quick look at what the microbiome is. So in short, microbiome is all the microbial cells associated with our body. And by different estimates, their number is either twice the number of cells in our body or 10 times more. So in terms of numbers, they are either twice the number or they are 10 times more than the human cells. And if you look at the DNA content, then it is definitely several thousand fold more. So amount of genes that are contributed by our entire microbiome is several thousand fold more than what our own genes are. And these microbes are present almost everywhere in the body. So they are present in the gut, nostrils, ear, skin, oral cavity, vagina, upper respiratory tract, breast milk. So you name the body organ and microbes are present there. And in the last 1.5 decade, lot of studies have been done on microbes present at these locations and their functional role. So when we talk about human health today, earlier we used to talk only about host genetics and lifestyle, but today we also include microbiome is an essential component of that. Last decade has seen lot of studies on correlation of microbiome alteration with a variety of diseases and how the alteration of microbiome is associated with some of the metabolic disorders. Earlier studies were purely associations where microbiome alteration was shown to be correlated with certain metabolic disorders, but today the studies are going into more functional aspects of the role of microbes in these metabolic disorders. So this is just example of some of the diseases that have been studied. So you have obesity, you have diabetes, you have coronary heart diseases. These are to name a few. These are the diseases that have been very well associated with microbiome changes. Now where does the Ayurveda come into the picture? So when microbiome studies started, gut microbiome was obviously the first one that was studied, and there is a common link that it is now believed that the food what we eat or even the orally taken drugs are metabolized by gut microbes, and then the entire thing changes. There have been umpteen number of studies which have shown that the efficacy of the drug also depends on your microbiome composition. It could make effective drug ineffective or ineffective drug effective. And Ayurveda also says that all the diseases start in the gut. So that's where is the correlation between Ayurveda and microbiome, and that prompted some of the studies which we have initiated. So the first question, most obvious question that we asked was whether the concept, there is an association between concept of Ayurvedic Prakruti and the microbiome, whether it is a gut microbiome or skin microbiome, whether there is any correlation with that. And second obvious question then is, do some of the Ayurvedic treatments alter the gut microbiome and their efficacy is some way correlated with the association of gut microbiome? So first study was done as a proof of concept to study the correlation between Ayurvedic Prakruti and the microbiome. This study was done of kind of, the study was not initiated as a study of association between Prakruti and gut microbiome. We already had some data that was done on microbiome, where we had looked at oral, skin and gut microbiome of these individuals. And fortunately, the site was nearby site, that is KEM Vadu Research Center. So all the volunteers were accessible. And during one of those discussions which you have, this topic came up and we got help from Girish. And we then this data, we went back, did the Prakruti assessment and then tried to correlate the Prakruti of the individuals and the microbiome. For obvious reasons, we did not, I mean, these things, Girish is the experts, I do not understand these things much, though I have learned certain things by passive learning. But we only chose those volunteers where one Prakruti type was predominant. We did not want to complicate this first study. So a mixed Prakruti, borderline Prakruti individuals were eliminated. And the data is rather skewed towards one Prakruti. But nevertheless, it has thrown in some very interesting observations. So this was our, I'll not go into the details of microbiome studies. We used all standard protocols for gut microbiome. We used stool samples. For oral microbiome, we used oral washing. And for skin microbiome, we used skin swabs. And again, in this case, for the study, we had taken samples from 8 different parts of the body for skin microbiome. But for the study, for economic reasons, all the samples were pooled and the microbiome study was carried out on the pooled sample. So I will not be able to tell you microbiome of each individual site. This is a pooled sample. And this is how the study design was done. Prakruti assessment was done by executing a questionnaire and with the help of a physician. And the preliminary results are very, very interesting. The first and foremost observation was that when we looked at the 3 Prakrutis, the microbiome composition of these 3 Prakrutis was distinctly different. You can see here, Vata, Pitta and Kapha Prakruti, the microbiome composition is distinctly different. If we look at more at the genus level, these differences appear more pronounced. And what you can see is that the important group Prevotella, its relative abundance changes amongst the 3 Prakruti types. And I would like to highlight here that in our global studies, we have observed that Prevotella is the group which is kind of a unique feature of Indian population that we have studied. In other groups, the other genera are more predominant. But in Indian population, whatever populations we have studied so far, Prevotella is the predominant genus, and it is relative abundance of this genus that was found to be varying in different Prakruti types. And Pitta Prakruti has higher abundance of bacteroids as compared to other groups. So bacteroids abundance was increased in Prevotella group. If we go to more further level, we can see, in a way, if you try to dissect it out further, we can see that bacteroids, desulfovibrio, parabacteroids, slakia and succinovibrio, they are more abundant in their abundance varies in the 3 Prakruti types. And parabacteroids was specifically shown to be more abundant in Pitta Prakruti individuals. Another interesting observation, if you look at the overall data, is that the Vata Prakruti individuals have more homogeneous microbiome as compared to the other Prakruti individuals. You can see that for the other Prakruti, their microbiome is more variable as compared to Vata Prakruti individuals, where the microbiome is more homogeneous. If we dissect it out further, what we could find is that only half of the genera were common in all the individuals, as against that 10%, 11%, 12%, these were the percentage which were specific for a Prakruti, specific for a specific Prakruti phenotype. So that was again a very interesting observation, that a specific, you can see here that 10%, almost 11% and 12% was the variation, this is the percentage of genera that was specific for a particular prakriti type. Similarly, when we look at the oral microbiome, again, you can see that the relative abundance of different genera is different in different prakriti phenotypes. Don't go by color, although it is blue here, it is actually Neisseria streptococci. So streptococci are more or less same, but the Neisseria abundance is seen to be variable in the different prakriti types. And then if you do again differentially abundant genera, then Leptotricha is more abundant in Kapha prakriti, Gamela is more abundant in Pitta prakriti individuals, and Campylobacter was found to be dominant in Vata prakriti individuals. We also did inter-prakriti comparisons, and we found that again there is a differential abundance of different genera in these different prakriti communities. More specifically, if you look at the skin microbiome, then you can find that in Vata prakriti individuals, Corynebacterium and Aliasepsis is found to be more predominant, so also Staph and Enterococcus. As against that, in the Pitta prakriti individuals, you can find Streptococci and Novosphingium to be highly abundant, and in Vata prakriti you can find again Neisseria and this Eleococcus to be more predominant. So different prakriti, and overall if you look at the picture, you can find that the skin microbial communities of three prakriti individuals it's found to be of three different types. They fall in three different planes, so they are three different types. So in summary, I can say in this study is that definitely the skin, oral and gut microbiome of individuals of different prakriti is different. There are some unique genera which is a characteristic feature of these individuals. It will be tempting to speculate their functional roles, but from our own studies, I would be very careful about having such interpretation, because our studies have shown that the genome composition of the gut isolates is very different from the similar isolates obtained from the other sources. So until and unless we have genomic information of gut gut organisms, it will not be appropriate to speculate too much about the functional aspects. Today only we can say that the microbial composition is different in order to tell how this is affecting their function in their respective ecosystems. We need to do more studies. So I'll not comment on those at this stage. Now the next obvious question is, could this microbiome is modulated? Do some of the Ayurvedic treatments modulate these microbiomes in good way or bad way? Of course, we would expect them to be in a good way. And then the first obvious example which we took was of Panchagavya treatment. And here again, the Panchagavya was prepared by a standard procedure by fermentation. We again got it made by a Ayurvedic expert, and we compared the microbiome of this Panchagavya preparation initially and after 30 minutes of fermentation, that is just before the administration. And without going into the details, what I would like to emphasize is that, this slide is more clear, that incidentally, within those 30 minutes, proteobacteria, which are non-healthy bacteria, their abundance was found to be decreased, and bacteroides group, which are friendly gut bacteria, their abundance was found to be increasing. This is within 30 minutes, and to me, this is a very exciting observation. Of course, this was a single study done on only one sample, and currently we are continuing these studies, doing multiple samples and trying to validate these studies. But nevertheless, I was quite excited by these observations. And then finally, to see whether some of the Ayurvedic treatments, they somehow alter the gut microbiome in a good way. And this was again a study which was done where we used Takrabasti for the therapeutic treatment of obesity. That experiment was already being done by Supriya Bhalera, and we analyzed the gut microbiome of the same individuals. So again, I will not go into the experimental details, how the Basti preparation are made, how Basti was administered. I will not go into those details, but I will quickly show you the results. And the results indicate that this is before treatment, after treatment and follow. So it indicates that before after the treatment, the diversity of the gut microbiome increases, and then after the treatment is stopped, in the follow-up, it comes back again.
And same thing can be seen here, that before treatment, after treatment, and in the follow-up. And if you look at the relative abundance of different genera, again you will see that this is the overall microbiome picture here. In the after treatment, the microbiome composition is changed, and in the follow-up again it has starting to go closer to where it was earlier. So in short, from the microbiological angle, I can say that this treatment brings about the transient microbiome change in the individual, and if the beneficial effect has to be continued, then probably a continuous treatment is required. For the same individuals, we have done other biochemical parameters also, and they also show the same trend. So this is in summary the three studies which we have done related to Ayurvedic treatment and finding out correlation of Ayurvedic prakriti and microbiome. And obviously this study cannot be done without help of Ayurvedic physicians. So Girish Tillu was the person who was involved in prakriti and microbiome assessment. Supriya Bhalera was involved in the studies on basti treatment, and H.S. Paleb was the person who was involved in the Panchagavya studies. And then these are my students who has worked on these projects. Dhiraj, of course, was overall bioinformatics in charge of this project. Shreyas and Dittaraj have worked on prakriti and microbiome assessment. And Dattatrey and Dhiraj have worked on, Dattatrey, Dittaraj, Dattatrey, Dittaraj and Shreyas have worked on prakriti and microbiome assessment. And Deepak and Kunal were involved in Panchagavya assessment. And another Kunal Dikshit was involved in the basti and microbiome assessment. And that leads me to something which is coming up based on our results of correlation between prakriti and the microbiome. Now we have planned a larger pan-India study, a pan-India microbiome study, and where we are going to assess 17 different communities with 3,400 total individuals, and this is pan-India study in 4 biogeographic regions. We would be assessing approximately 200 individuals each, where we are of course going to do a microbiome study, but with that, along with the microbiome, there is a component of the prakriti assessment also. So with the help of Ayurvedic physicians, we are going to do prakriti assessment of these individuals, and we'll have a much larger sample data. The earlier study was done on some 50 individuals. This study is going to be done on something like 3,500 individuals on pan-India basis in different biogeographic regions. So I believe that this will give us much more interesting information on the association of the Ayurvedic prakriti and the microbiome. And of course, our participants, Ayurvedic point of view, our participants are Trans-Disciplinary University in Bangalore and School of Health Sciences of Pune University are the participants in this study from the prakriti assessment point of view. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We have time for a couple of questions.
Dr. Shouche, I should congratulate you for this very pioneering study which you have done. Wonderful. Just one question of mine is that you have very clearly found differences in the microbiomes of the three prakritis. So my basic question is, what is the causal relationship? Whether we are of three, belong to three prakritis because of the three kind of microbiomes, or the other way, vice versa?
That's a universal question asked in most microbiome studies, that what is cause and what is effect. It's very difficult to dissect out cause and effect in this case, but what we see is that as was shown in one of my slides also, that microbiome is also one of the factors that contributes to your health in addition to host genetics. So it's one more, you can say, environmental factor or epigenetic factor that can affect your health. So, and in some cases, the cause and effect relationships have been shown. The knowledge is just emerging now.
First, a comment. Vinobaji Bhave described that Prabhate, we have in our Indian tradition, Prabhate Kar Darshanam. In the morning, you must look at your hands. What I did last day, what am I going to do with my hand today? He said, Prabhate Maladarshanam. And Mala Pariksha in Ayurveda is a highly complex thing, as Mutra Pariksha was also earlier in Europe. Uroscopy was a huge specialty at that time. So, have you correlated microbiome with the gross physical and biochemical and other aspects of gross stool examination, macroscopy, microscopy? One question.
Right.
Second question is that it has been demonstrated that firmicutes are definitely associated with obesity and diabetes. And India is a diabetic capital of the world now. So you do have firmicutes, and you showed also in relation to fermentation also high level. Because in mice, if you have the obese mice and you transplant obese mice to thin mice and thin mice to obese mice, that transplantation of microbiome changes the metabolic profile. So, in view of our priority, are there any projects of obesity, diabetes with the microbiome that you are focusing on?
Okay. So, I'll answer first question first. Yeah. I mean, what you said was the assessment of stool and the microbiome. That's it's a very good suggestion. We have not done that in our previous studies, but in the proposed study, we want to do that, looking at the stool quality and the microbiome. We plan to do that in a bigger study. And coming to the second question of diabetes microbiome association, yes, I mean, we have done studies on diabetic individuals in our population, and the most interesting aspect of whether diabetes, or we have done a small scale obesity study also, the most interesting observation in our scenario is that the picture is very different from what we would see otherwise in the Western world. In Western world, as I mentioned about Prevotella, in Western and even Asian studies, Prevotella is shown to be a neutral member. So whether you are obese, lean, diabetic, non-diabetic, Prevotella abundance does not change. But in Indians, Prevotella abundance changes. So the moment you get diabetes, your Prevotella population goes down, and as your parameters related to diabetes improve after the treatment, Prevotella abundance goes up. So, I mean, that is a very significant observation, and that's why the observations made in the Western population on all these dysbioses will not be applicable. We need to do our own studies in India and understand better about the role of microbiome in such disorders.
So, any comments on the personalized microbiome when we are talking about the personalized treatment? So, any comment on personalized microbiome?
So the whole concept of doing microbiome studies is to have personalized treatment, because each individual is supposed to have his own unique microbiome, and the idea of doing microbiome studies is to develop personalized therapies and personalized medicine. So, if not to an individual level, but at least to a community level.
So, there are couple of papers which are already published. There is also a third one. One talks about the microbiome of Indian population, north and south, and then another one on Prakriti by, I think,
right,
Chauhan et al.
Yeah,
and
yeah, yeah.
Darpan et al.
Right.
So, how much the Prakriti microbiome studies correlate with what you have done, because it appears that the population is identical. They did from Maharashtra
the study which you are talking about, that result and our results correlate. In fact, some of the algorithms which we have used in our studies, we used them to, we developed a microbiome signature, and we tried to find out in their data whether these microbiome signatures predict the correct Prakriti, and we found that to be working.
So both the results match.
Right.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Then why the Chauhan et al. Result don't match? Microbiome.
I said they match.
Yeah, the Darpan et al., the microbiome study of North and South Indians, when you co-segregate along with the Prakriti data, there is a total redistribution of the microbiome in these individuals. And secondly, the way that we have sequenced, right? So, it is only few V2 regions or V3 regions, but not the entire 18S ribosomes or even entire microbiome shotgun sequencing was not done.
Yeah, in our study also, our study is based on amplicon sequencing only. That is currently the
economically feasible method. So, but again, as I said, in a larger study for a subsection of the population, we'll be doing a whole metagenome, and there would be probably in a better way to say this. Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sir. Sir, one small question. Sir, in Ayurveda, Prakriti is somewhat consistent. It remains consistent throughout lifespan of an individual. But microbiomes, to my understanding, they are susceptible to drug, dietary and lifestyle changes. So in these two so variable things, I mean Prakriti, which is very consistent, and microbiomes, which are susceptible to changes, dynamic thing. So where is the correlation between Prakriti and microbiome?
See, the microbiome, up to 3 to 4 years, the microbiome is dynamic. From 3 to 4 years up to 65 years, microbiome is stable. And beyond 65, again, it becomes unstable. So the window of 4 to 65, the microbiome is definitely stable. And again, in microbiome, there is something called as core microbiome, and there is what is called as pan microbiome. So when we talk about microbiome changes, those are largely about the pan microbiome that changes. Core microbiome is believed to be constant in an individual. So whatever perturbations occur, those are transient, and the core microbiome is always retained. And when we talk about microbiome signatures, we talk about microbiome signature of an individual, we talk about core microbiome. Microbiome signatures associated with the diseases, they are primarily into, I mean, the transient changes that happen because of certain diseases, those are into pan microbiome.
Okay, thank you very much. In the interest of time, we should move on.
Sir, I request you to please felicitate Dr. Shouche.